Before we move on to the finalists, I'd like to introduce our keynote speaker, and it's really a great pleasure that we have Melissa Terras here with us today. Melissa's been a great friend and a thoughtful partner to the library as we've been traveling on this journey supporting digital scholarship and research. She served on the British Library Lab's advisory panel from the very start, and we've worked together with her and her colleagues at UCL to explore how researchers and students are changing the way they do research to understand better how they are incorporating digital data into their methods and projects, and understand how we can possibly change the way teaching and learning incorporates and provides greater insight into these techniques. It's been my pleasure to attend her inaugural lecture when she was appointed a full professor of digital humanities at UCL. And I've seen her to continue to go on to build up one of the strongest digital humanities research groups anywhere. And more recently to be appointed even vice dean of research at UCL. She's been a real thought leader in the field and the author of many, many works. And I think one of the interesting ones of late is the important Defining Digital Humanities volume, which she edited. And it not only brings together, I think, the seminal works in the field, but it weaves them together into a coherent tapestry. And I hear it's now, you know, it's the best-selling book in the area. So I do recommend that. And of course, many of us will know Melissa from her blog, Adventures in Digital Cultural Heritage. I recommend it. It's really required reading for people who follow and are interested in the field. So please join me in warmly welcoming Melissa Terras to the podium for her keynote today, Unexpected Repurposing. Melissa?
My own drinks. Thank you, Adam. That was a lovely introduction, and I'm really pleased to be here and to talk about some of the work. So it's been really interesting to have been part of the British Library Labs as part of their steering committee over the last few years, and I've learned a lot about how a major institution would work when it's trying to deliver more of its data to people. But I, of course, I'm an academic, and I'm trying to use data as well as sometimes making it in my day-to-day life. And what I'm here today to talk about is reuse of data and how we can best reuse data, how we can best deliver data to be reused, how as academics we can encounter data and reuse it from other people. Now, when you work on a major digital project as an academic, you might make data for yourself, and you generally make data so that you can prove your own hypotheses or investigate your own questions. If someone happens to reuse your data or your software, that's great, because we all write it into our impact plans that we're going to do that in the first place. Unfortunately, it's very, very rare that digital data from cultural heritage is actually reused. And of course, if you're a major library like the British Library and you're digitizing content, it might be that you never digitized the content in the first place with a research question in mind. So you have a slightly different remit, which is trying to make sure your data is delivered in a way that other people can reuse it. And there's a certain amount of guessing goes on as to what would be best to provide and how you can provide it for other people. I wanted to look just a little bit about the drivers for digitization and why we would reuse data, or we want data to be reused in the first place. Well, firstly, there's the ethical issue and the resourcing issue. Like, if you're putting a lot of time and money into creating a data set, it makes perfect sense that you would spend the time and the money making it available for other people to use. So there's a resource issue. But then there's also a mandate from funding councils. So if anyone has filled out a project grant over the past 10 years from the major funding councils in the UK, you will have promised to make your data available to others for up to 10 years after the end of your project. So there's a promise, and the funders are trying to get us to do that. Now, I've included in this kind of grouping of just a few funders of digitization, other funders are available, The New Opportunities Fund, which was lottery funded, this was a project for the millennium. Remember the millennium when we all got excited about things? Everyone was to digitize, do some mass digitization for the millennium. There was a huge amount of money put into digitization in the UK. And we're now 16 years on from that. I had a master's student this year look at all the 250 New Opportunities Fund funded projects for the millennium. More than 60% of the content is now dead and gone. It's gone. So they might have signed up to say that they would provide this material in perpetuity, but digital material is really fragile. Luckily, we're now 16 years away from the millennium, and we've got our act together a little bit more about how you would archive this stuff, how you would save it, and how you would deliver it. So we also have a set of guidelines about the data in the first place, and a set of frameworks, whether that's for metadata, whether that's for how you store your data, whether that's for how you archive your data. So hopefully we won't be in that position now when we're digitizing content, and in 16 years' time, things should be about. So as well as the mandate for the funding councils, we have frameworks to help us structure data and deliver it that other people might be able to use it. Then, of course, there are rights and licenses. And it's only been in the last few years that the community has got its act together to be able to grant rights very easily in a way that other people understand. And Creative Commons has had a lot of good in our community to be able to easily affix the copyright and legislative issues around data to allow people to take that and be able to reuse it without worrying too much about whether they're breaking the law. And then finally, we have a host of digital infrastructure which has been set up to allow people to store data, to allow people to share data, so they can share it. I put up there the logo of the much-missed Arts and Humanities Data Service, which did get shut down 10 years ago now. So we were ahead of the game back then in trying to build an infrastructure that would allow people to share mass data sets. But now we're turning to things like GitHub or Zenodo and allowing big data sets to be made available. Additionally, people like the British Library, also UCL as an academic institution, we're building frameworks to allow people to share large data sets. I've just put up a terabyte of image data on the UCL servers other people can have a look at as a reference data set. And even 6 months ago, that would have been an impossibility. So all these things come together. The mandate from the funders, the will of the projects, the frameworks to deliver data, the licensing, and the way that we can actually share stuff. And they've coalesced into a movement over the last couple of years called OpenGLAM, Open Galleries, Libraries, Archives, Museums. And over the last 2 or 3 years, there's been major institutions who have been putting large-scale data sets online and saying to people, well, come on then, have a go, have a play. And what I want to talk to you today in particular about is our reuse of one large data set from one large institution. And as luck would have it, that is the data set from the British Library. It is, of course, the British Library 19th century digitized books. So I want to talk just for a little minute about this data set and how it came to be. The British Library 19th century digitized books has 65,000 recently digitized editions. What happened in 2008, back in the day, Microsoft and Google got themselves into a race as to who was going to digitize all the books or all the rare books in libraries and make them available online. Due to copyright restrictions, of course, these are based books before the turn of the last century. And Microsoft decided that it was going to go into partnership with a few major libraries around the world. In May 2008, it released a press release which announced it was going to digitize these books from the British Library, and it said 75,000 pages are being scanned daily. That means it would take nearly a year to scan this collection, scanning it at 75,000 pages at a time. Unfortunately, about a month after they made this press release saying that they were going to digitize this, Microsoft decided to close this program because Google had won. Google had got there first. And that was that. They digitized all these books and then they hadn't done very much with them. But in 2012, they approached the library and they said, like, do you want your data back? Let's give you the books back. And they were placed under a CC0 public domain license for commercial and non-commercial use. And so it then gives the library a data set that they can use, a data set that they can experiment with, and a data set that they can have to figure out how to deliver to people. what is this data set? 65,000 books, mostly from the 19th century, some a little bit earlier. All of them, of course, are in the library catalogue. So there was a selection of the books made. It's only about 3% of the entire library that got digitised. And the books are real books, so they were digitised, both outside covers, then you get the actual pages themselves, and you can see that they're a mix of text and images, which means when you digitise them, when we say they're scanned in, but they would have been captured on camera, then you can use OCR to generate text. I just want to show, I don't know if you can see right at the top, you can see that there's some things that have got green underlines, and that's where the OCR might have done something a bit wrong. So there are questions already about, have we got all the text digitized and have we got the OCR fixed? And we have to know about our data sets that we're going to use. We have to know about whether we're dealing with data which is checked and correct. So there's already questions about, if you're going to make a big data set, can you trust it? And so that's what the library has to do. It has to deliver a trustworthy data set. So you get the OCR generated text. And we also have the XML, which is generated by a program called Abbey Fine Reader, which does the OCR. So that encodes everything in XML. It's quite a large data set. And then the digital content is put back into the library catalogue. So for all these books that were digitised, you can download them one by one at the moment from the British Library website. But then we can do more things with it than just that, right? It's not just about making the text available one by one. At the British Library themselves, it was Ben Osteen and his team noticed that within Abbey Fine Reader, if you're using that to do OCR, it strips out all the images so that the images don't mess up the OCR. But that means you can extract all the images very easily. So they developed a program where they extracted over 1 million images from these books and put them up on Flickr and a public domain license, allowing people to reuse them. And here's one of the images up on Flickr Commons that you can go and see and download and reuse yourself. Then we can start to play with it, right? We've got the mechanical curator here, which is James Baker and his team, where they're putting up this content randomly upon the hour to show people the spread of the content. There's wiki pages up here about at the British Library about how people have taken and reused these images from the books and the text from the books on a case-by-case basis. And there has been some really interesting reuse of this material, both for research, but also for creative purposes. And we'll hear some about that today when it comes to the British Labs competition for this year. My favourite one is this one. Someone took some maps that were in a book and made Father Christmas's Circumnavigation, which is a most secret study by the Royal Geographical Society. So this is some of the creative works which happen with the content when you make it freely available online. But and you can also search through just historical text if you're interested in doing something a little bit more complicated. You can see the whole lot of this data set other places. So other people have taken this data set and are now delivering it through their mechanisms. There is a problem with just historical text at the moment. You have to have an institutional login from a certain number of universities or other societies to be able to get access to the British Library data set. And that gives us a clue as to how difficult it is to take this content and use it en masse. You need a certain amount of infrastructure behind you to take 65,000 books and to run them through queries and to do stuff with it. And you need to be able to pay for that some way. So there are some issues with how we can deal as individuals with 65,000 books in the first place. And I'm interested in this. What can we do with 65,000 books? So if we just take the text from this data set, that's 224 gigabytes of text, 224 gigabytes of XML, which we should be able to take and do very interesting things with. That is slightly too big for most people to handle. It's slightly too big for most people to run on their laptops or their computers. It's bigger than your hard drive. So it's scaling up, it's just big data. If you talk to some computing scientists, they wouldn't say it was big data at all. But it's scaling up beyond what an individual researcher can do with this data set. And you'd still have to come to the British Library and get this on a hard drive, right? Even though we have the technical infrastructure in place, you're not going to be sending 224 gigabytes of stuff over the internet. Like, if you want this, it costs 50 quid to buy yourself a 250 gigabyte hard drive and to come and get it or take it away. But we're talking now about a different set of skills to look at this, the complete books, and also a different set of technology that you could start to do analysis of this. So this is where UCL comes in. For those of you who don't know, UCL is just down the road a bit, about 500 metres that way. And I've put up some logos here of the people that we've been interacting with the data set. There isn't a logo for the Arts and Humanities faculty because we don't have one. But I'm in the Arts and Humanities faculty, although a sixth of me does report to UCL Engineering as well. UCL Centre for Digital Humanities, we believe, is the only department for us, only centre for digital humanities, which reports equally to engineering sciences as well as to the arts and humanities. And we have buy-in from the computational sciences as well as history, English, French, all of the humanities subjects that you would think of. And we've been working closely with UCL Computer Science and also UCL Information Studies to work with our students on this data. That's a picture of one of our high-performance computing units. Now, if anyone knows about high-performance computing, there's a leader table for who's got the most computing in the world, and they all compete against who's been buying the next big machines. And sometimes UCL's number one. I think at the moment it's about number nine, but next week it'll be number one again when it buys another rack. So there's a lot of universities which have massive computing power, and at UCL, compute power is not an issue for us. The way this financial structures work is that any member of academic staff can get access to research computing infrastructure and use it for their research. Any member of staff can do that. And so what can we do with 65,000 books if compute power is not limited? And I am aware of the privileges that I have in saying that as an institution. So we're doing this as a kind of flagship to test some of the infrastructure at our institution, as well as seeing what happens when you point some high-performance computing unit at some books. But I'm going to start not at the HPC unit with researchers. I'm going to start about the work that we've been doing in engineering science with our master's levels computing science students. So here is a very boring page about their dissertation, their individual project. And at the end of their master's year, they have a three-month project that the students work in teams between 4 to 6 people. They work together and they're given an industry sponsor. So a lot of people work with real industry sponsors. And that's those images down the bottom, that's taken from this webpage about the different industry sponsors that work with the computing science students, so Microsoft, Logitech, that kind of thing. Most of them go out to computing science industry. Some of them end up in the financial sector, and most of them go into work within the financial sector in London. That's where most of the leavers from this programme go. And over the past 10 years, we've built up this industry link to these different types of industries where they learn how to process massive amounts of data. If anyone in the audience, by the way, has a computing friend and they want to have some computing science students, Dean Muhammad Ali is the person to contact about this. We're always looking, we have 300 of these master's students a year, we're always looking for more industry links. And we thought, well, what would happen if instead of sending them to a major bank or to Microsoft or to Logitech or to Java, what would happen if we sent them to the British Library? What would happen if we sent them with their briefcases and all dressed up? They get dressed up like when you first meet them, like as a business meeting, and they kind of come in and they're like, yes, you're the client and they're going to sort something out for you. What would happen if we let them come into the cultural heritage sector and actually do something? So we had staff and students working together from the British Library. It was James and Adam. From UCL, it was me, Dean, who manages the student projects, and Professor Tim Virish, who is the deputy director of UCL DH, and he's in computing science. And then a whole host of students who were there to have a look at the British Library data sets and see what they could do with them to improve the quality for, or the search facilities for users. And they do, they treat it like a business. They treat it like scoping out a three-month project that they're going to build, they're going to manufacture, they're going to test, and they're going to deliver. This was also sponsored by Microsoft, so we used Microsoft Azure as the platform for this, a cloud-based platform where they could do as much processing as they wanted. And then we have the different stakeholders, people from UCL Computing Science, Digital Humanities, and also the British Library. And the question was, how can we search this data set differently? What do humanities people need from searching a data set? There's advanced searches that you can't do just now on the British Library catalogue, such as Boolean searches and other advanced searches that you might want to retrieve some type of content, but not others. So they built 5 different APIs on the Microsoft Azure platform, and they implemented them with all the data we ran about with the hard drives of data getting at various places. And they met regularly with some humanities scholars, And they realize that some of the things that people want, they want bulk download of text-based metadata queries. So what people want to do is search within the 65,000 books to find the 300 books that actually have content which is relevant to them. And then they want to take them away on their laptop and do whatever it is they want with them. So how can we offer that from an architecture point of view? What do we have to do to build a computational system which will allow users to do that? And then once you've found your 300 books that you want, you might want to do something like run some word frequency lists over it. You might want to be able to see some of the text inside very quickly to do some easier research. So they built some demonstrators to show this. And this is a student project. It's branded like it's from the British Library because that was their remit. They had to build something which worked and was functional. Unfortunately, I can't actually give you the URL for this. It was only online for 3 months while they tested it, but I'll walk you through how it works. So here we have a basic keyword search, but they also have advanced searches. So if you wanted to search for the title where the word home was mentioned in the title, but you didn't want people to be talking about London, you would find three books in the data set which matched that. And then if you wanted to, you could search within that and do some text analysis on just those ring-fenced three books, and you could also download the whole lot and take it away and do whatever you wanted with them. Now, that was really interesting for the students to be able to get some experience with the British Library data set, but it's also interesting from an architecture perspective for the library to think about if they're going to allow mass downloads of material, how can they actually get it to work in a way that is affordable and scalable? So really, the contribution that their dissertation made was about that architecture and detailed how they would build a system like this that efficiently could deliver mass downloads of content in a way which would actually allow users to use them. There were some other student projects. I didn't work on these, but just to give you a look at them, one was called Pick a Guess, and this was to help improve the metadata that around images to feedback to allow people to be able to search for them better. And it's a game. It's a game where you're given some images from the data set and you're asked to guess the word which connects them all. And then that's machine learning. It feeds back into the data set to be able to label them all and to correct the metadata which is there. Another one called the British Library Machine Learning Experiment was about the generation of metadata from the images, or the generation of new tags for the Flickr dataset so other people could find them. And how this worked is you chose an image at random, and then it looked for the text surrounding that image, and it would try and compute some more tags about the dataset. So I looked, this one's still online, by the way, that's the URL down there, and some of it is still working. You can look, you can browse, you can't search for anything, but you can browse and it will give you a random image and it will generate metadata from it. So my random image was the exhumation of the remains of Napoleon Bonaparte, and here we have a letter. And they've generated new tags. They've said that it's tall, it's colourful, it might be black and white, it might be sheet music. It's 65% certain that the sheet music. It's 43% sure that it's printed music and 22% sure it's handwritten. So there are some issues. It's really difficult. It's really difficult to generate tags from text, mostly because images don't actually sit exactly where the text describing them is. But this showed that the students could take this, they could build the architecture, they could run some machine learning, and then they learned a lot about the difficulties in actually creating such a source such as this. I just want to pause for a minute and think, what are we doing here? What are we actually doing? We've got a data set from the British Library. We're working in close partnership with the British Library. So this won't scale, right? It won't scale if everybody in the world wants to send their computing science students to the British Library to do something like this. But it does benefit the students hugely. One of the students commented to me, so they must have been, you know, they're in their master's year, so they must have been, what, 22, 23. One of them commented that they'd never been in a library since they were 12. They were pure computing scientists, right? And this was a whole new world to them because they had not realized about the type of data libraries have, what libraries have, what they could do with it. And it really opened their eyes as to a different sector. For the students themselves, it gives them a different line on their CV when they go for jobs after, that they haven't just been following this well-trodden path of the master's students of, you know, go to UCL, do your project with Microsoft, go and work somewhere else. But it gave them something different to make them stand out from the crowd. It also allowed them to interact at a one-to-one basis with the people in the library who knew a lot about information, a lot about technology, and it gave them a completely different experience. But from a digital humanities point of view, if I think about UCL Centre for Digital Humanities, what we're doing here is we're pointing pure computing scientists at cultural heritage at a student level, and that itself is very, very rare. Most digital humanities centres are or come from places like English literature, and it's come from the humanities. But we're actually trying to use cultural heritage data sets in a way which benefits computing science students as well. So it's been a big win for all of us, and I hope that actually it's been useful for the library. Maybe we can talk about that in the questions as well, about some of the things they learned about the infrastructure. This project, however, didn't actually do much for new research. This was something about our students, but also how about they can deliver data sets to other people. And I am particularly interested in what new research we could be doing with this data set. So I want to move on now and talk about the second project that we've done with the British Library Open Data Sets, which is enabling complex analysis of large-scale digital collections. This was a project which was funded by JISC Data Spring. Not the summer, but the summer before, we had a three-month pilot in which we could try and see what we could do with this data set. And the issue was, how would we take this and deliver it or allow researchers to search it? What could we do to make it easier for researchers to search within this data set and generate complex queries? So we had this three-month funding from JISC, which allowed us to put the data set up on UCL's high performance computing unit and to be able to run some searches with it. This is another slide of one of UCL's high performance computing units. This one's down in the basement of Tottenham Court Road. And it turns out, so UCL's got this massive lot of computing. But when you look at the graphs of who's using it, this is an internal report about who is using UCL's high-performance computing. And you'll see at the bottom, two people are majorly using it, engineering and maps. Maps isn't geography, maps is maths and physical sciences. You'll see next to that a little blank, which is the arts and humanities. So all the faculties are paying for this facility equally. We all have to put in the same overheads to have this facility, and no one from the arts and humanities has used it. I did try. We tried previously in 2006. We got some census data from Ancestry, and we were trying to run some queries on that, and that was the largest scale data set that we could get our hands on at the time that would warrant doing any type of complex high-performance computing on it. And it didn't work because census data is so fragmentary. So we kind of retreated and went, oh, we have to wait a little while until we can get our hands on some open data that we can actually play with. Interestingly enough, though, you'll see at the end of the graph, the yellow one that says SHS, that's social and historical sciences. And there are people from archaeology and anthropology who've been using the high performance computing unit at UCL. It was just the people from arts and humanities, like, we have done nothing with it. So the question is, what can I do as a director of UCLDH, and what can we do as a team at UCLDH to try and encourage or to figure out what's gone wrong? Why is no one using it? What can we do to the infrastructure to change it? What can we do to the facilities and the research structure to actually allow this facility to be available for people? So we got our 65,000 books from the British Library, and we ran back and forth across the road with our hard drives. Just to remind you, these are mostly from the 17th to the 19th century, 224 gigabytes of XML, and we have as much computing as we want or need to throw at them. But we also need support. So the support was provided by UCL Research IT Services and UCL Centre for Digital Humanities. And we chose four humanities researchers, so two PhD students and two early career scholars or junior lecturers who were working on particular things which weren't actually that computational. They were interested in their own topics and their own research areas. And we were going to run some queries for them based on these research queries. So how are we going to turn these research questions into computational queries? That's the first question. How can we help them change their thing that they want to look at about that Victorian London? How can we change that into a list of queries that we can run across the server? And how can we learn from the researchers about their needs, wants, desires, and their method? But also, what can we do with our infrastructure? Is our infrastructure going to actually support this in the first place? So here are some results. Oh yeah, it worked. It actually worked. It took some time to get this relatively small data set up on our massive computers. Why is that? They're mostly configured for maths and engineering and chemistry. So these people come with one large data set that they're putting on the unit. They're running one or two complex queries that might take, you know, 3 or 4 days to run, and they're outputting the answer, which might be a visualization. This isn't what we were asking it to do. We wanted it to put up 65,000 different files and to run maybe one really simple query, but across them all, and to output maybe a page from each book. So it turns out that the infrastructure wasn't set up to support that, because we had one metadata server that every time it queried the data, it had to run backward and forward. For the chemist, that was once. For us, it was 65,000 times. And the poor thing fell over a lot. So that led to the question, when you were procuring this unit, you didn't think about anything beyond chemical or mathematical data, did you? You didn't think about us coming with our 65,000 books and going, no, we want to do something now. So we had to look at how our infrastructure was actually set up in the first place. And it took a little bit of work to, it took about 2 months to actually get one query running across the data set. So we were trying to put a square peg into a round hole with the data set, but this is actually really useful for IT services to understand what type of data sets that we have. And if we look at any of the other large data sets that we have, last week the JISC and the Wellcome launched their UK Medical Heritage Library, which again is another 68,000 books in the public domain. We could get them and put them on UCL's high performance computing, but then that makes it 130,000 things we're querying, not just one. So we have to change the infrastructure. So what we were doing here with this project, we're really showing where the infrastructure was breaking, which is incredibly useful from a systems perspective so that we can start to design that a bit better. So we got it working. The first search that we ran was professor, looking for a professor. And this is actually a research project that I'm working on about professors in children's literature just now. And I'm very interested in the growth of the professorita in the late latter half of the 19th century, because that's when we first start seeing them appearing in children's books. And I wanted to see if there was a growth in the mentions of professors over time. And bam, there you go. It seems to be that we have some kind of growth. Well, I will come back to that. It turns out that this is what most of the humanities researchers want. They want to run one or two simple queries on a word or a phrase, and then they want that data set to be delivered back to them. So they want to find the 4,500 mentions of this over time, and then they want a page from each of the book so they can download that, give them a gig of data that they can take away with, and they can then look through it themselves. And that, again, is a very different model than in the computational sciences or the chemical sciences of what people want from the high-performance computing unit. What we're really using is to find the needles in haystacks, right? And then we give all the different needles to the researchers, and they can go away and line them up and talk about the different kinds of needles. But that is what we need as humanities researchers. We need to find the things in the first place so we can then go and do close reading and close analysis on these things. So some little bit more complicated materials. This is one of the case studies that we have. This is for Oliver Duke Williams, who is in Information Studies and Centre for Digital Humanities at UCL. He's interested in the history of diseases and the history of people moving about and the history of culture and how that maps onto census data and information about diseases. So we looked for disease references across the data set. The most interesting one here is cholera, which is the red line. So he was interested to see if the cholera outbreaks in London affected literature and what people were saying in Victorian novels. So the first red bar that we see going along, that is when the first outbreak of cholera was in London. And we can see that before that, no one was talking about cholera in these books until there was a real life outbreak, and then bam, there you go, everyone's got their people dying of the cholera in the books. So we can show the interaction between medical data sets and also the literary text that we have within this data set. There's further work to be done about the relationship between the outbreaks of these various diseases and how they're mentioned. But this just shows the kind of things that we can start to see or we can start to visualise if we point some fairly complex queries. But actually, it's not really that complex. It would take us, you know, a little while just to key this up, 12 hours for it to run over the HPC unit. But we get these kind of nice visualisations at the end, which can help us understand a little bit more about the data set in the first place. Another case study is Will Finlay. He's a PhD student at Sheffield, and he's interested in images. He's interested in images in print and how they change. So just as we could extract the Alto XML, and we can extract the images from that for the mechanical curator, we can tell the size of the image within each page. So this is a visualization of the size of images across the data set. Now, at the very top, you'll see that some books have 100% of the page with images in across the whole data set. But there's a change in production in about the 1800s in the way that books are produced, where you could start to put text around images. Before that, you could either have your image stand alone or you could have your text, but you couldn't have them put together. So we see a change in both the amount of images which are available, it's partly to do with the size of the data set, and also how they were filling up the page and the relationship to text. We generated enough data with 2 days of messing around with what we had is we had people from UCLDH, people from research computing, and the researchers in a room with different stations, and we were going from one to one, like, let us code up your query, let us run it, let us visualize it. And we generated enough data within a couple of days for Will to be basing chapters of his PhD about that. He's now spending the next 6 months, next year, analyzing the data that we generated for him so he can do things with it. So it shows just a little insight, a little input from research computing can generate a lot of information which we then need to do close reading on to go through and actually understand. What did it tell us about delivering this kind of service to arts and humanities researchers? The first one was the derived data sets. People want to find what they're interested in the data set, and then they want to take it away. And they want to be able to do text analysis themselves, or to make graphs, or to do close reading, are all the things that we teach people as part of digital humanities that you can do with data. They're quite happy to take the data set and go away and do with it when it's a manageable size, but it's about facilitating searching for things that might be useful to the research topic in the first place. The second thing is it's very, very important to document decisions which have been made, both about the data set and how we've delivered it. So it turns out that the data set, these 3% of books from the British Library, are mostly rare books, and there's a lot of travel books in there. I don't know too much about the curatorial decisions that were made to select the data set, and that's something that researchers have to know. What are they basing these things on? And this is why Google Ngrams falls over, because we have no idea what that's running against. And if you're a researcher, you have to know what the data set is in the first place and have to have all the decisions documented about how it got to you and how the things got to you and how your query was coded up. For example, I looked for professor across the whole data set. I didn't look for prof. You know, that's a decision. I need to go back and fix that. We need to document that. Am I really talking about all professors, or am I only talking about when they spelled it out longhand? So there's some issues here about documenting what you've done. The other thing is about telling people when data sets have been fixed or defined. If we start adding more stuff to the high performance computing unit, so it's possible to add the UK Medical Heritage Library, we've got another run of a large newspaper has just gone up in the last week. We need to make sure we're telling people when they searched their data, what they were searching on, and has it changed at any point in time? Have we changed the data so that they have a fixed point in time to refer to, so they understand the corpus they're delivering with? And then we also have to deliver normalizations. So I showed this earlier and said, yay, we can show the growth of professors over time in the book set. Actually, that's not quite the whole story, is it? Because you need to normalize the data to be able to say that. And a normalization would be, well, how many books are there in the data set for over that year? And it just turns out there are more books towards the latter part of the 19th century than there were earlier on. So of course you're going to find more mentions of the word professor. And you have to know the number of books to be able to make that judgment call. And then once you've got that data, you can calculate the percentage of books that include professor in the data set, and we can discount the huge spike at the end, because that's 100%, because there's only one book that year and it has professor. So we have to go back to the normalized data and go, well, what does that mean? And statistically, the only chunk of this that we can actually look at to get anything that's relevant is from about 1802 onwards. And so we can take out that bit of data and go, is there a trend? Can I show that more books were talking about professors? Because this was when the government started to fund the universities. There was more universities. People were aware of more universities. There was more professors. People were talking about them more in public discourse. And yes, there is a trend of about 10% rise across that, that 90-year period. So people are talking about professors more. But I needed to know that normalized data, how many books there are, how many words there are, how many images there are, to be able to do any bona fide statistical analysis. And this is an information literacy task. And we need to make sure when we're giving people this information or giving people these tools that they understand the data they're basing things on and they're understanding the whole data set in entirety so they can actually be speaking things which make sense. We found that there were only about four or five queries that people actually wanted, or the four researchers we were working with actually wanted to do. This is unlike, say, the chemists, who every single time they're running a visualization, it's different. What we have is a massive textual data set, and we have humanities researchers who want to look for all variants of one word or a phrase, so that it might be the name of an institution, and they want to find every single time that institution has been mentioned within these books. They want to return these keywords in context. So they want a page. They want the whole page of the book returned to them so they can read through themselves and decide whether or not this is relevant to them. They want to do Boolean searches. So they want not searches for a word or phrase. So, for example, I had a colleague who was looking for managers, but not waste managers. So it's two different things. Let's return different sets based on these Boolean searches. And they're looking for searches for a word when in close proximity to a second word. So if you want to find if two people have ever been mentioned in the same page, we can run a search to look for two phrases or two words within 100 or 200 words of each other. And that, we think, would give us about 90% of what arts and humanities people want. There was also the stuff based on the image metadata, but most people in arts and humanities are looking for mentions in text. So that means if these are just four simple searches, these are basic recipes that we can provide for people. And we have highly skilled librarians at UCL, as do most institutions, who are perfectly capable of running these research queries for people if it's just a case of changing the phrase in a recipe each time. Which means instead of it being this massive project where you have to get a computer programmer and someone from UCLDH and someone in a room together for 2 days to run one query, we could be training up 12 librarians at UCL on these basic recipes. And then if anyone wants to run, like, find me the British Library across the states, it wouldn't be in there, but, you know, find me the British Museum across these data sets. Bam. It's not us always going back to research computing to use it. We could be training information professionals who are perfectly capable of doing this stuff. So that was an eye-opener to us that actually the barriers are solvable if we use institutional contacts and the people who are actually trained to deliver information. So if you wanted to try this at home, if you wanted to take the British Library data set and put it up within your institutional context, we would say that firstly, you need to invest in research software engineer capacity to put up the collections in the first place, to make sure they work on your infrastructure across different data sets across the GLAM sector, but then you need help. The technical barriers are too huge at the moment for most people to take these data sets and get them deployed on these units. You need the resources to be able to pay for someone to do that, and you need some support from IT services to get them up in a way that can be searched. But then when you have that, there are people around who are perfectly capable of doing the basic searches, and we advise that you would invest in training library staff to run initial queries to give people the data sets to take away with them and to make sure that the data sets have enough information that they're coded up so that they can trust them at the end of the day too. this has had long-term benefits for UCL. We've just bought some more computing. So this year, earlier in this year, there was the launch of Grace at UCL. So we have a new high-performance computing unit down in, it's either Slough or Swindon, down that neck of the woods. It's shared with Imperial and with King's and with a whole lot of people, but it's a massive data centre. And when they were procuring this, and when they've been procuring other things now, the arts and humanities needs have been taken into account as to the different types of data sets that we have. Which means in the past week, we have put up a major data set, which we paid for from Cengage, from a newspaper, that we've put online and is now available for people to search. We have a site license for it. It's on the High Performance Computing Unit. And it was quite easy. That was led by Ulrich Tida, who's sitting at the back. It's quite easy for people to run a search on that. It was easy for them to deploy the data because we'd had this 3 months of experimenting time to see how it was going to work in the first place. And it means that going forward, we can now base research projects based on the data sets. We can start collecting the other data sets which are coming on stream, the OpenGLAM data sets were becoming available. We can very easily put them on UCL's high performance computing units, and then we can ask researchers, what is it you want to search for? Let us code that up for you. Let us get access to that at very, very low cost. Again, I want to just pause for a minute and say, what are we doing here as a Centre for Digital Humanities? Well, this, rather than facing the engineering students, this is facing the arts and humanities researchers. It's my job to look out for these type of opportunities where we have infrastructure and we have computational infrastructure that we can use, and to say, well, wait a minute, why aren't we using it? How can we use it? How can we break down the barriers? We're just at the start. Over the weekend, we've been kind of putting together a crack team of people to do some very interesting things with some of the newspaper data we now have access to, because now this is opening the doors for a vast number of people. We're still having talks with the British Library about how UCL's computing facilities can help not just UCL staff, but maybe other people too, because there's an issue with getting access to this at scale. And we are part of a university, we are part of an academic institution, but we want to be able to help other people too who want to run these type of searches. And for a digital humanities centre, it's absolutely our job to be looking out for these chances to do different things, to be using the resources which are available to us, to be aware of our privilege and to be plugging in the things which come on, and to keep our ears up and listen out for the different data sets which are coming up, and so that we can deploy them and do interesting things with them. So I just want to thank the people at the British Library for helping us. We needed a lot of hand-holding when we started off at this. Now we're at the stage where we can take a data set and actually run things with it. It has been great fun, as well as very intellectually interesting, to be working on this project. Everything for our project that we did for the Data Spring is up on GitHub. So if you want to look at any of the visualizations, if you want to take the code and run it against your own high-performance computing unit, if you have an e-science center, you know, it probably works in a very similar way to UCL's one, then it's all up there on GitHub. And I just want to go back to what I was saying about data reuse and recycle. The most important thing, as from a research perspective, is not only that we help people get access to the data, but we help them reuse, recycle it, and do good research. And I want to thank everybody who was involved in this project. This wasn't just me. This was the British Library and Labs, the digital curators, people from computing science, people from, we call it Blue Clubber, British Library, UCL, Open Books, although some people hate that acronym. All the people that worked on there, and also UC Research IT Services. And it took every single person on this slide coming together to experiment with the British Library data set to make good things happen. Thank you very much.
And do we have some roving mics? Yes.
Hello, I'm David White, from Head of Digital Learning at University of the Arts London, so the arts side of the arts and humanities stuff. It seemed to me, thank you for the talk, really interesting. It seemed to me that that it's still quite early days, in the sense that the questions that you're asking of the data are quite simple. Which is not a criticism. I suppose my reflection on that, my question to you is, how do we foster researchers' thinking to be able to ask more sophisticated questions.
Because, absolutely. Yeah. So for the, sorry, there's a light shining in my face, that's why I'm going to let it. For this project, for the data spring, it was a 3-month project, and this was the output of, you know, 2 days worth of grubbing about and doing some visualizations and people coming to us and saying what our needs, wants, desires were. We are just now at the stage where we can tackle various data sets and do something interesting with. So quite seriously, over the last week, I have been assembling a crack team, like the A team, that we're actually going to do something real. And we're going to do something, which is a new question. We're going to do it big. We're going to do it across this huge data set, across one of the major newspapers, as well as the BL Books, as well as the UK Medical Heritage Library. We're actually going to start asking some difficult stuff. We're going to be coding up things. So I am aware of how simple these searches are. But I do think for a lot of humanities researchers that the simple searches are the way in to use in this stuff. They're the way in, and they can often find the instances that they're looking for that they couldn't otherwise have found through the mechanisms which are available. So there is the kind of 4 recipes. That's the easy stuff, but you're absolutely right. Now we have to go on to go, right, what's the killer thing that we can show that you couldn't otherwise have done? And we're only at that part of the journey just now. And there's other people, obviously, worldwide that are doing large-scale text analysis that are even a little bit further on than us. But I don't think that we're communicating to the broader audience about how you can do this, how it is possible, and why you should be thinking of it. And it'll be really interesting to think at how the questions change over the next 3 or 4 years when people get this under their belt.
Thank you.
Hi. Hi, Melissa. I've got a comment and a question. One was when you were talking about kind of the 4 key types of query that people wanted to do, and you mentioned bringing librarians into that and showing my bias as a librarian. I thought maybe you were playing down possibly the expertise that librarians could bring to that kind of question. Another example you gave was kind of the use of synonyms for searching, and that's the kind of thing that librarians used to do when I started out, was help researchers develop that kind of query, not thinking about the different ways in which the set needed to be queried to cover all the requirements. And I think there are some skills there that are perhaps a bit dormant in the librarian community at the moment, but that could be used. So that was my comment. My question was, you were talking about how you found the restrictions of the high-performance computing facility as it was kind of configured. And I kind of wondered, does it in any way actually start at the right point? It seems to me like tweaking something that's been designed to do science for the purposes of textual analysis might not even be, you know, the right place to start at all. And maybe we need different kinds of configuration of high-performance computing for the types of query that you want to do versus the types of queries that a chemist wants to do.
Okay, so the first point, I'm sorry if I was meant to kind of be bigging up the skills of my librarian colleagues. So, because one of them, Anne Welsh, is a bibliographer, so she was very keen on, like, well, we used to do this in the 1980s when I worked in the library, like, we used to do this. So she was very keen that was part of it, that if we bring librarians into it, that they can actually be doing more. They can run the simple searches, but then they can improve the searches and the queries themselves to help people get to the information they need. The second point is, realistically, it might be easier just to go and use like Amazon Cloud, really, if you want to do some process, if you had enough chops, like, but then you'd have to have the money to pay for that kind of thing. And this is about using the infrastructure which has been put in place across most UK universities to support people, which is a slightly different question. So we did have that conversation early in the project about whether we should just go, you know what, it's not going to work. We should just actually throw some money over here at this data processing point. So there are other options for people. But if we wanted to use the computers that we have, then we are using ones which have been designed for the sciences and only used by scientists so far. The stats for UCL about whose usage, that's across the whole of the UK. There are very few people using these high-performance computing units which were rolled out as part of the e-science kind of drive over the past 10 years. So it's about infrastructure and about... if I want a query done, it's costing me, you know, like £50 rather than whatever it would cost me to run on Amazon Cloud. So I think it's about infrastructure and being able to reuse the infrastructure that you have.
Thank you.
one last short question.
I have one. Can I ask a question? Can I ask you a question, Adam? What did you get from the library side, for the students coming in and helping out with the data sets, and for the master's students, that from the library point of view, how has that benefited you?
Well, I guess as part of, you know, we've been trying to touch a lot of people in the research community, and I think one of the things that really turned us on to was the possibility at the master's level, and some of the other activities that we've done at the library, like the Off the Map competition, has even pushed that kind of excitement down, you know, into the undergraduate level. And I think the capabilities of the undergraduate and master's students are, you know, really, really remarkable. And it's, I think, helping us to, you know, see where we might be able to engage. I think there's a lot of, there's a lot of work to do in that space. But I could, you know, I could imagine seeing these data collections that are, for the most part, today being used by sort of postgraduates, PhD, and later on in their career, being picked up aggressively in undergraduate and master's level teaching and projects. And I think that would, you know, if we do that for 5 or 10 years, it will completely transform the expectations and the skill sets that people are bringing to research projects that can benefit from digital content and data.
Thanks.
So, can we join me last time in thanking Melissa so much for her for a presentation to us, super interesting and extremely relevant for the purposes today.